Welcome to Questions for Christians. In this show, what we do is we show that you can have a decent conversation between a Christian and an atheist. I'm the atheist. My name is Bernie Dehler. I've been working in the computer industry since 1984. I got a four-year degree in electronics engineering technology. In 2007, I got a master's in ministry degree from Luther Rice Seminary in Georgia. And then in 2009, I left the faith and became an atheist. I also wrote a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. And my guest today is Fazale Rana, also goes by the nickname Fuzz. Hey, Fuzz, welcome to the show.
Hey, Bernie, how are you? Thanks for having me.
Pretty good. We had a previous discussion on a previous show, and it turned out really good, and I thought we'd go a little further this time. We have five topics to talk about, and these were suggested by Fuzz, so I think they should be interesting. And Fuzz, why don't you, I'll give you a minute to explain to people who you are for people who have never heard of you before.
Sure. Well, I'm a biochemist by training. I have a Ph.D. in biochemistry from Ohio University, and then also did a couple of postdocs at the University of Virginia, University of Georgia. Spent 7 years in research and development, working for the Procter & Gamble Company, and then almost 17 years ago now joined Reasons to Believe, which is a Christian organization designed to demonstrate the reliability of the Christian faith by looking at the latest advances in science. And so I work with that ministry on a full-time basis, using my expertise in biochemistry to, again, make the case that there is a creator, that biology points to the existence of a creator.
Okay, and you wrote a number of books. Do you want to list some of the books that you've written?
Yeah, sure. I've written a couple of books with a co-author by the name of Hugh Ross. One is Origins of Life, which takes on the question of abiogenesis. Another book with Hugh Ross is Who Was Adam? That looks at the question of human origins from a scientific and a biblical perspective. And then a couple of books dealing with biochemical design and synthetic biology, respectively. One's The Cell's Design, and the other is Creating Life in the Lab. And actually, in May, have another book coming out called Dinosaur Blood in the Age of the Earth, where I look at the question, does the recovery of soft tissue remnants in dinosaurs and other fossils provide evidence that the Earth is young, or is it possible to understand that evidence from an old Earth perspective?
That's interesting. And I suppose you say it's from an old Earth perspective.
Yes. Yeah, I take the position that those discoveries are consistent with an old Earth.
Which might be kind of surprising for a lot of Christians. Okay. Yeah, I find that very interesting. And you mentioned you have a Ph.D., right?
That's right, yes.
Where'd you get your Ph.D. from, and what was the field?
Yes, my Ph.D. is in chemistry with an emphasis in biochemistry from Ohio University. Not Ohio State, but we're the other guys, Ohio University.
Yeah, and I appreciate, I haven't listened to your podcast for a while, but I appreciate how you always have usually articles on the latest news, like Neanderthal interbreeding with humans and all kinds of things like that. It's kind of interesting.
Thank you.
Okay, so we'll get into the questions here. We got 10 minutes each. And then if we have time later on, I think we might get do some overtime topics. So anyway, we'll start with the first question here. And that is, this is a question you submitted. You said, in The Cell's Design, this book you wrote, I present a watchmaker argument for God's existence based on the features of biochemical systems. Do you think this is a valid argument? So do you want to set the stage for that question?
Yeah, sure thing. You know, a lot of people who try to make the case for intelligent design spend most of their effort essentially critiquing the evolutionary framework, with the idea that if evolution can explain the complexity of the cell, then it must be the work of an intelligent designer. And so in The Cell's Design, I try to take a different approach, where instead of focusing on what I perceive to be challenging for the evolutionary paradigm, I wanted to make a positive case. What is it about the cell's features that I think positively point to the work of a creator? And I actually go back and I retrace some ground in history and kind of adapt William Paley's watchmaker argument to biochemical systems, making the point that many of the features of biochemical systems are similar to human designs and therefore reflect the work of a mind. This is, again, in the same vein as William Paley, who argued a watch requires a watchmaker, therefore biological systems require a divine watchmaker, where Paley was comparing the features of biological systems with the features of a watch. So it's a similar kind of approach to making a case for design, and again, where the goal is to make a positive case as opposed to critiquing an evolutionary framework.
Well, I guess I got a couple of comments. It's kind of maybe in reverse order, and I'll probably forget what they are, but one comment is that you said the designs, did you say the designs mimic human design?
Yeah, the designs in biochemical systems are mm-hmm. similar to human design.
So in other words, like a motor or a rotor or something like that, and biochemical
exactly.
rotor is like a rotor or a motor that we have?
Yeah, exactly.
I guess one interesting thing there, though, too, is I think that humans are also creating things that in many ways are actually better than biology, though, too, now. I mean, like when you think of supercomputers are amazing that don't exist in nature. We create vision systems that are better than animals might have, for example, you know, seeing in the dark. And so, I mean, we can create things that are actually better than nature. What about that? How's that fit into it?
Yeah, well, I mean, let's take your example of a supercomputer system. You know, it's interesting. There's a new area in nanoscience and nanotechnology called DNA computing, or at least a relatively new area. And the idea behind DNA computing is traces back to Leonard Adleman, who is a scientist at the University of Southern California, who for fun was reading a book on molecular biology and noted that the enzymes that are manipulating DNA, let's say during the process of DNA replication, are literally functioning like Turing machines, where the DNA is essentially a string of information that the machine or the enzyme will operate on as the finite control, producing an output. And on that basis, he essentially devised the notion of DNA computing, where he and others are now building computers using DNA and, again, the enzymes that manipulate DNA. And one of the things that you can do with DNA computing is you can elicit massive parallel computations. And as a result, you actually have systems that can solve, with DNA computers, can solve problems that silicon-based systems can't solve. And so, you know, I would actually argue that these DNA computers are more powerful than our most powerful system. Now, the drawback is reading out the data while the computation is practically instantaneous. Reading out the data can take, you know, several days of work in a laboratory. But the point would be that, again, there's a similarity between a human design and a biochemical system.
Well, you know, since I work in the computer field, I know a little bit about computers. I don't know about the DNA computing. I've just kind of surfacing knowledge about that. I thought it was like in regards to storing memory or something. But, I mean, just off the top of my head, it seems to me like the DNA code is very inefficient as far as, well, that's just for code, you know, for coding for codons, for example. I'm not sure how they're using that for processing. But you said you can process in parallel, but computers are, that's what the supercomputers are doing. Even the computer chips now, they have what they call multi-threaded. I have an advanced chip at home that has like, I think it's 12 or 16 CPUs in it. It's a high-performance one because I got it from work. They gave us some free chips for working on the project. But that's small scale. I mean, even a phone, we got a quad core phone here. It's got four CPUs that could work in parallel. And that's just for a phone. But I mean, the supercomputers, they have, I don't know, maybe thousands of nodes working in parallel, I believe. Like I said, I haven't read the articles, but I can't see how DNA would be a better processing thing. It seems to me the next big stage actually is quantum computing, and that's the astronomical benefit there, because then you can use the uncertainty states for supposedly all kinds of processing. Instead of just 0 or 1, you have the 0, you have the uncertainty state, which is supposed to be incredible, which is all brand new also. But there's no, but we don't see that in nature anywhere. This is something where humans are going way beyond nature.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think you do have anything to my knowledge that's comparable to quantum computing in the biological realm, and clearly that would be a competitor to the idea of DNA computing. But where you get, I think, the massive parallelism that far outstrips supercomputer systems is essentially you're dealing with, individual molecular systems. So, you know, even like in a gram of DNA, even though DNA is a very large molecule, you know, you've got enormous number of molecules. Probably, you know, a mole would be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. So even if you've got, you know, a tenth of a mole or a hundredth of a mole, you basically have, you know, 10 to the 21, maybe 10 to the 20 operations happening in parallel in a test tube. And that's where you're getting the massive parallelism. And plus, because you're dealing with things at a molecular scale, these computers presumably operate at near 100% efficiency, or there's a very, very high, you know, efficiency with these systems, in that you don't have issues with heat dissipation and you know, have to be concerned with, you know, things like that. So that allows for greater efficiency. But, are these systems perfect? By no means. But, I mean, they are incredibly impressive systems.
Well, do you know anything about assembly programming, assembly code, machine code?
No, I don't really.
I mean, because machine code, this is the bottom line, where the machine actually carries out instructions, and usually it's like load a value into a register. I can't remember now how to do adding and subtracting and stuff. But there's a lot of like loading and shifting. And I'm just trying to imagine, how would you get DNA to compute? How would you have like a loop on there, like an if-then loop or something?
I'm a biochemist, not a computer scientist, so in a sense, I don't know that. But I've got a couple of books on my shelf on DNA computing where people are actually working out those kind of problems. But, I mean, the idea would be, again, that you've got these enzymes that are functioning like Turing machines, and so the principle would be similar, you know, to kind of Alan Turing's insight, where you can take these very simple operations and by stringing them together in different combinations, develop rather complex operations. And in effect, you've got a lot of things that you can do with DNA and enzymes. There's a lot of different types of manipulations that are possible that allow you to essentially create, you know, these kind of complex tasks that you're referring to.
Well,
but the larger point would be, you know, the similarity between, again, a Turing machine, which was an abstract concept in Alan Turing's mind, and the fact that it's physically instantiated, you know, in the cell. So when DNA replication is happening, it really is a computer operation that's happening that it fundamentally is similar to how Alan Turing conceived, computer operations. And the point would be that is suggestive that the systems inside the cell come from a mind.
Well, some people say like the DNA code is like a computer code, for example, and I would take a lot of issues with that. I mean, on a very surfacey level, you can say that, but if people really took that seriously, I think there's a lot of misconceptions on that.
Yeah, well, I think I would agree with you when people throw that analogy around in a way that's not very thoughtful. But I think in this instance, at least with this application, with DNA computation, it really is code at least at some level. It literally is functioning as code.
Okay, well, our 10 minutes is up on that one already. So we'll move on to the next one. Do you want to, I guess, you know, we both didn't have enough to say there. So this is why we really have to focus in on try to maybe make one point and just talk about that.
Sure.
So here's the second question. You say, in Creating Life in the Lab, that's your book, your book title, I argue that advances in synthetic biology indicate a creator must have played a role in the origin of life. What accomplishments and synthetic biology tell us about the origin of life? Or what do accomplishments in synthetic biology tell us about the origin of life? So how would you like to set that one up?
Yeah, well, one of the things that I think is really exciting in terms of the technology frontier is the very real prospects that scientists are going to be able to create artificial cells in the laboratory. And these are referred to as protocells, where you have these chemical supersystems that are beginning to assume the properties of a cell. And my thesis in the book, Creating Life in the Lab, is that the amount of ingenuity that's required in order to pull off even steps towards a true cellular entity is so enormous that it indicates that empirically intelligent agency is a critical ingredient in transforming chemicals into living systems. You know, because again, you've got these scientists that are developing these very impressive strategies to create artificial cells, and then on top of that, developing rather elaborate, ingenious protocols that are carried out in the lab by intelligent agents who are highly skilled. And so the argument would be that this is an empirical demonstration that intelligent agency is, again, a critical ingredient in bringing about life.
So this is what I understand you to say, is that in the lab, they are working on creating cells or subcells. And as they go through this process, it's excruciating detail on every part of the process. It has to be excruciatingly controlled. It's extremely precise, and you have to be extremely careful, otherwise the whole thing doesn't work out right. And you're saying because there is such extreme careful work going into every single step, and there's so many complex steps in all this, therefore it shows that life must have been created by God, because obviously nature can't do these kind of complex steps. Is that your argument, basically?
Yeah, it is. Although, in a sense, I'm not saying that nature can't do that, but rather I'm saying, again, I'm trying to frame it in a positive framework. In other words, we know from synthetic biology what it takes to produce a protocell. And again, intelligent agency is an indispensable component, and therefore the argument would be, if that's the case, and we demonstrate this empirically, then it's reasonable to think that life's origin too required, again, the work of a mind. And so this is an attempt to frame another type of design argument that would be independent of the watchmaker approach.
Okay, well, let me tell you one of the things from my experience, and then you can tell me what you think of that. One time at work, this was many years ago, I was working on a circuit board, and there was a problem once in a while accessing memory. A certain memory location didn't work. And so I wrote a program to hammer this section of memory. And I got it to, because I'm hammering a certain section of it, it basically failed repeatedly. And then I was able to put a scope on it and actually look at the timing and all that. And we found out what the problem was. So just in the normal course of things, you know, it was very random. But when I created a special program for it, I can zoom in on the problem and see it. So I'm basically replicating in the lab something that didn't happen very often in normal use. So in the same way, why can't we say, as an evolutionist, I'm an evolutionist, that, you know, it took many years and many different weird circumstances for life to create, you know, like in scaffolding, you have to build one step at a time, and it happens at different places, different times, different events. And it took a long, long time. And so, of course, we can't reproduce that. But if we, you know, if we use our brain, we can shortcut it, like I did with my example. We can, you know, hurry it along by using our brain power. So basically, we're shrinking the time it takes to make something because we're removing all the extra variables that knock it out in a lot of cases. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. And again, to some degree, I would say you're somewhat making my argument for me, because again, you're talking about short circuiting variables, but then when you start thinking about what would this process require, you know, and here I'm talking about the origin of life, what that process require on the early Earth. And then you're looking at such a complex chemical environment and physical environment that the variables are so enormous that there may not very well be any kind of pathway by which you could, even in that complexity, over a long enough period of time, produce things in a coherent manner that are going to lead to stepping stones towards the emergence of a protocell. Because, again, it's that the process of short-circuiting and minimizing variables in the lab that I think is where the intelligent agency is coming in to do it in an efficient and in direct way. And again, on the early Earth, the environment is so complex, it's difficult to envision, you know, how you would ever short circuit those variables, particularly when, in many instances, the variables are actually counteracting one another.
Well, let me explain it a little different way. Let's say, for example, you have to do A and B to get C, and then you have to do C and D to get E, and then you have to do E and F to get G, and then G and H and get I. And some of these can go in parallel, like A and B can be make C over here, and then D and E can do F over here, and then the two can get together or something like that. And then once you get half of it built up, let's say the whole thing gets destroyed because of some other process comes in, or some kind of chemical or something toxic comes in, so the whole thing has to start over again. But sooner or later, this process gets through. So this is why maybe in nature it took a long time to get through, and all they're doing in the lab is they're all these killer things that come in from the side that knock it out, they're just eliminating those, and so they're just speeding it up.
Yeah. Well, and I don't think I would make the statement that, just because, let's say we're talking about A going to B, which is a critical step in generating, the origin of life, but that A going to B is inhibited by other processes that are happening on the early Earth. There are other reactions that are converting A to C and A to D and things like that. So you've got these competing reactions. You also got inhibitory, processes. It's not to say that you're not going to get some A eventually converting into B thermodynamically. That would have to happen to some degree. But the question is it productive enough, even given a long period of time, is it productive enough to ultimately affect the origin of life? And so that's, in a sense, the argument is that the intelligent agency is playing a critical role in short-circuiting the process to make, again, the origin of life actually happen.
Okay, but the thing is, we don't know really what the early Earth was like. I mean, that's what the science endeavor is all about, is trying to figure out what are some possibilities. Like Ken Ham always says, the young earthers, were you there? No, we weren't there. Sometimes they say this is probably what it was like. Sometimes they say this is what it was probably like.
And I would agree that we don't know what the early Earth was like, but we have, rock formations that go back to 3.8 billion years. We've actually got, some things like zircon crystals that even date prior to that period of time. We've got, solar system formation models and things like that. So from that, we've got clues as to what the early Earth was like. And most certainly, it's going to be a chemically complex and physically complex environment. And we can speculate reasonably what kind of materials would have been present on the early Earth. One of the things that origin of life researchers have been very successful at is actually identifying a number of conceivable processes that could have been in operation on the early Earth. And so when we, or we could go to things like the Murchison meteorite and look at the kind of, organic materials that are present in the Murchison, and then use that kind of as a proxy for what would likely be present on the early Earth. So, don't know exactly, but we do know enough to say it was a chemically complex environment. And we would have an idea of the types of compounds that likely would be present, and we'd have an idea of the physical nature of the environment of the Earth, at least enough to say that complexity is going to be, inhibitory and frustrating to any kind of coherent sequence of steps you'd need to bring about again, the origin of life.
Well, you know, I think, though, something to always consider is to be a little bit humble, too, about what we really know in science. I mean, for example, if you go back maybe 50 years, certainly 100 years ago, I mean, before Einstein's time, in fact, I mean, before Einstein's time, you would say, well, obviously there's space and obviously there's time, and they're two different things. And then Einstein showed that space-time is a fabric, and you can warp them both to gravity, and that changes everything. So all the theories you have about space and time basically get thrown out the window when you understand that there's a space-time fabric that's warped by gravity. So I don't know. I think we could be just as naive about the early Earth as far as, I mean, you know, there's so many different ice ages that they at one point they didn't even know about ice ages, and then they said there's multiple ice ages. And so, and you know, another interesting thing too is if they actually did create life in the lab, they said, look, here's a bunch of chemicals, basic chemicals from the element table, here's a process, and look, we have actually life formed here. This is a possible pathway. A creationist could still say, like, well, yeah, that's a possible pathway, but that doesn't mean that's the way it happened. That just proves you did something in the lab by controlling things.
Yeah, well, you know, and, you know, to your point, you know, it is possible that somebody could come along and have that, you know, that insight that is radical that suddenly changes the way that we look at things like the origin of life, and suddenly the problem is solved from a, you know, a natural process standpoint. But in a sense, we're appealing to the future, you know, to try to discern, you know, is the origin of life the work of a mind or is it the work of evolutionary processes? And the best we can do is take the data that we have available to us at this point in time,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, try to draw conclusions that are reasonable with the idea that our conclusions are ultimately going to be provisional. That's just the nature of science.
Okay.
But to me, you know, it's I'm deeply impressed with the work that I see as a biochemist. I'm deeply impressed with the work that I see in synthetic biology, and you know, the ingenuity is astounding, and so I applaud the people that are doing that work, and have enormous respect for them. But I also think that, you know, the level of ingenuity that they're bringing to the table really does work against a naturalistic approach to the origin of life. I think it really is providing an empirical demonstration that time and time again, you know, the one thing that stands out in that work is the ingenuity of the researchers.
Well, yeah, and I guess we're at an impasse there, because to me it doesn't mean anything. They're just speeding things up by getting rid of a lot of other variables and defeaters along the way. So, okay, can we move on to the next one?
Oh yeah, sure.
Okay, this is probably my favorite, I think. You wrote, could mitochondrial Eve be the Eve of Genesis? I want to quote from you. This is also in your book, Who Was Adam? I wanted to quote from you. There's an article you wrote, says, it's called Were They Real? The Scientific Case for Adam and Eve by Fazale Rana at reasons.org. This is 2010 easing PDF file.
Okay.
So basically, here's what you said, quote, moreover, analysis of mitochondrial DNA, which provides insight into the origin of the maternal lineage, indicates that humanity traces back to a single ancestral sequence that could be interpreted as a single woman. Likewise, characterization of Y chromosomal DNA, which provides insight into the origin of the paternal lineage, indicates that all men trace their origin back to a single ancestral sequence that could be interpreted as a single man. These astounding results harmonize with the traditional reading of the biblical account of human origins and suggest that Adam and Eve likely existed as real persons who gave rise to all humanity. So you're trying to say that mitochondrial Eve and Y chromosomal Adam can refer back scientifically to refer to Adam and Eve in the Bible, correct?
Yes.
Now, I believe there's actually an error in the sentence here I want to show you about. Here's the sentence. You said, Moreover, analysis of mitochondrial DNA, which provides insight into the origin of the maternal lineage, parentheses, indicates, and this is my issue right here going forward, indicates that humanity traces back to a single ancestral sequence that could be interpreted as a single woman. So right there you said indicates that humanity traces back to a single ancestral sequence. And that's, it's not true, technically, that humanity goes back to there. That's only the woman lineage, not all humanity.
On
the Y chromosomal atom, you do clean it up and you say there, you say it indicates that all men trace their origin back to a single ancestral sequence that could be interpreted as a single man, but you didn't say the same thing for the woman.
Yeah, and the reason is because when you do the mitochondrial genetic variability studies, men and women are included in that with the idea that the men are getting their mitochondrial DNA from their mothers, as are the daughters, but the men are not passing their mitochondrial DNA on to their offspring. And so, but all humanity would trace an origin back through mitochondrial DNA to that single ancestral sequence, whereas the pattern of inheritance with the Y chromosome indicates it's essentially the male lineage exclusively, because women obviously don't have Y chromosomes. And so that's why there's a difference.
I thought that mitochondrial DNA, like you said here, provides insight into the origin of the maternal lineage. I thought that meant that males, it says nothing whatsoever about the mother of the males. In other words, they could come from a different mitochondrial Eve or a different kind of Eve or a different woman.
Yeah, but in other words, the men are not passing the mitochondrial DNA on. The women are, the daughters would, but the mitochondrial DNA that I have, in other words, you could take samples from men and women with mitochondrial DNA and then work your way back to that single ancestral sequence.
Okay, let me ask you this question. Let's say, for example, you trace a woman, let's say you trace all the women back to a mitochondrial Eve, okay? And mm-hmm. then there, let's say mitochondrial Eve has, there's another woman at that time by definition, because that's what mitochondrial Eve is, means all women today go back to that woman in time, mm-hmm. and all the other lineages of women have died out, right?
Right.
So let's say, for example, you trace back all the women to a certain mitochondrial Eve. Now, let's say at that period in time, there is another woman who has her line going, but her line died out, but there's a male that came from her. So there's no way to find out if that male, I'm thinking, if that male, there's no way to find out if that male, who it came from.
I think, yeah, right. In other words, if the male, in your scenario, if the male, let's say you have a woman and she has two male sons and no daughters, then her lineage would die out with those sons. Yeah, that's actually correct, right. But the point that I'm making is you're tracing, with regard to mitochondrial DNA, the sequences back to a single female individual, and that single female or a single ancestral sequence, I'm sorry, that does correspond to a individual. Now the question is she one among many Eves, or is she a singular Eve?
Well,
and my argument would be that in a sense you can't really make that determination. Now, evolutionary biologists, as you're pointing out, would say, well, there were many Eves.
Yeah, let me go along with that line. I mean, this point I'm bringing up got a little bit confused because I got thrown off by what you said there a little bit. I got like three other points. Let me bring up some other points.
Sure.
This is an analogy I came up with. And I think this shows obviously that mitochondrial Eve is not the Eve of the Bible. Let's say, for example, I actually have come from a family of 12 kids. I have 11 siblings. Let's say all 12 of us kids went on the moon to a moon colony. Then on the Earth, there was a nuclear war, and every human got wiped out. The only humans alive now are on the moon, and that's my family. Who is Mitochondrial Eve at that point?
Well, it would be if you have a sister, it would be your sister would be the Mitochondrial Eve.
No, I have six sisters.
Huh?
I have six sisters.
Okay, right. Well,
wouldn't Mitochondrial Eve be my mom? Because she's the last common female to all living females.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that would be correct.
Okay, so, and obviously my mom is not Eve of the Bible.
Right, but what you've done is you've created a scenario that could account for, again, the data that you see with Mitochondrial Eve. But let's say your mom was created de novo, and your father was created de novo. And then now let's go through that scenario that you've just described. She still would be, it would look no different than if there were many women on the planet and only one of them ended up having, again, offspring that survived. In other words, you really can't make a discernment or a discrimination between those two models.
Okay, but I mean, you're totally changing a different picture there when you say, you know, my mom or dad was made de novo, because that's not what we're dealing with now. I mean, I'm giving a thought experiment that could actually happen in real life, and there's ramifications of scientifically of what that would mean to Mitochondrial Eve. So basically what my example is showing is that from an evolutionist viewpoint, through evolutionary history, there have been lots of women in our ancestral line. There have been lots of lines of descent. And it's just that when you look at all the living women, you can trace those down to one woman because the other lines have died out. And so what I'm doing is I'm giving you a thought experiment where all the other lines have died out, and now we have just the current one, and that is who Mitochondrial Eve is. And of course, my mom is not the Eve of the Bible. So in the same way, I'm saying when you look at all the lines of descent and evolutionary wise, the Mitochondrial Eve just shows you what's the last common female of all living females.
Right.
Even in evolutionary theory, Mitochondrial Eve had a mother. It's not like she's the first human. She actually came from something else too, and she would have had the mitochondrial from her mom. It's just that her mom technically probably would have had other children with different mitochondria. That's why it stopped at Mitochondrial Eve and not her mom, for example.
Right. And my point would be not to say that your scenario is unrealistic or can't happen, but my point is I don't think that your scenario and a scenario where Mitochondrial Eve is actually the first woman created de novo are indistinguishable. I don't think those two theories, because what would it look like if there was an Eve from which all humanity emanated? The data would look the same as if you're looking at the scenario you're describing where there were many different Eves and all the different lineages die out. In other words, those two scenarios are indistinguishable. And so my point would be that if you are approaching things from a creationist standpoint, that you could look at the data from Mitochondrial Eve as being compatible with what Scripture says.
Well, one quick point, though. According to evolution, Mitochondrial Eve is a scientific term, right? I mean, the secularists use this also, right?
Yes.
And they fully mean that, they fully accept that Mitochondrial Eve had a mother, right?
Mm-hmm.
So... you're just saying instead of saying, well, it keeps on going back, you know, it could have just started there, I guess.
In other words, I'm saying I don't think those two scenarios are indistinguishable.
Okay, well, that's why I tried to give my thought experiment, because I think it shows like, aha, that's what Mitochondrial Eve is, but obviously that's not the Eve of the Bible.
Right, and again, I would not disagree with you that in the sense that your scenario could explain the data, but I think my scenario could explain the data as well.
Okay.
And so, in a sense, you're at a point where you've got, in effect, an impasse, in my view, that those are two equivalent explanations. Now, to be fair, I mean, evolutionary biologists would come along and say, well, you've got, you know, genetic variability data that, you know, in which you can calculate effective population size, and they would argue that that data indicates that there were thousands of individuals, not just a single individual, based on genetic diversity. And so one of the things we do in the update to Who is Adam, I'm not sure if I did that or not in the article that you cited, but in the update to Who is Adam, we talk about a number of studies from conservation biology that raise questions about how trustworthy are those population size estimates. So I'm not disputing the fact that evolutionary biologists interpret the data differently than I do, nor am I disputing that their interpretation lacks merit. But what I'm saying is that if you take a perspective that there, and you embrace a traditional biblical understanding of human origins, mitochondrial Eve and Y-chromosomal Adam provide, I think, affirmation of that biblical view. But I don't think it necessarily means that an evolutionary perspective lacks merit or can't account for the data either.
Okay. Looks like we need to go on to the next question. These are going to be shorter time because we're running out of time. So question four, can intelligent design be a part of the construct of science? One thing in there I'd like to say is, you know, when I was a Christian, I tried to be a young earth creationist, but I couldn't really do it. It was just asking me too much to believe that I couldn't believe it. So then I was kind of an old earth creationist like you are. And then I accepted evolution. I became an evolutionary creationist and kind of went through a little bit of ID in there too, intelligent design. But I just want to bring up this topic. There's two kinds of intelligent design out there. One is, this is what the evolutionary creationists say. There's a traditional kind of intelligent design, which they like, and that's basically based on the Bible, Psalms 19:1, for example. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. And they accept evolution, so they would say that's God's majesty and everything, shows his wonderful working and all that. But the Discovery Institute is promoting a thing called intelligent design. And that is the kind of intelligent design I think you're talking about. And you would like to see that kind of intelligent design be a construct of science. Is that right?
Well, you know, my focus isn't necessarily to try to reform the nature of science. You know, my focus is basically to show people that scientific discoveries harmonize with a biblical view of the world. That's really my focus. But, you know, I do think that, you know, apart from, you know, what my agenda is, so to speak, I do think that you could incorporate intelligent design into the construct of science. For example, in effect, we already are doing that. When you look at something like SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, I mean, that whole enterprise is predicated on the ability to distinguish basically signals emanating from some kind of star system to distinguish signals that would arise through natural mechanism versus signals that would arise from intelligent agency. And so there's an instance where we are incorporating intelligent design into the enterprise of science. So the question would be, why couldn't you extend that idea and just say, hey, when it comes to the origin of life, you know, let's say, you know, why couldn't we take the results from, let's say, synthetic biology and say, you know, is this, is it, you know, reasonable to posit the idea that life emanates from the work of a mind? And if so, you know, how would we make that, how would we distinguish that, or how would we identify that?
And by
that?
The work, so, you know, there's that famous cartoon where there's two scientists and they have this equation, and then it says right in the middle, then a miracle happens, and then it carries on, and they says, I think you should be a little bit more specific in this step. You know that cartoon?
Yeah.
It's a pretty famous cartoon. I mean, isn't that exactly what ID is trying to say, is that basically you need God to do a miracle, just I mean, like, for example, you don't believe in evolution. You think whales just popped into existence from nothing, and humans just popped into existence from nothing. So it's just like in your when you explain how things happen, it's just like then a miracle happens, right?
Yeah. Well, I would say. Well, yeah, I would say that you are positing that a miracle happened. But it doesn't necessarily mean that the laws of nature were necessarily violated in that process. I mean, God could have created outside the laws of nature or within the laws of nature. So, I mean, you've got those options available to you if you embrace design. But I think the idea would be that there's a direct intervention in some capacity where the intelligent agency is exerting, you know, his will, you know, on the created order in such a way to affect some kind of an outcome. So I guess you could call that a miracle, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you can't probe.
Do you have a problem with God violating laws of nature? Because I thought you just said that it wouldn't violate the laws of nature.
Well, I mean, there could be miracles in which God isn't violating the laws of nature. There could be, you know, miracles where God is doing something outside the laws of nature, you know, or God could work within the laws of nature. Both could be viewed as being miraculous events where, you know, God, again, is working within the laws of nature, outside the laws of nature.
Well, let me bring up one obvious. We only got like 2 minutes here. I just wanted to bring up this one thing here. One problem with the intelligent design community is that they don't really seem to have a very coherent position because, for example, Michael Behe's one of the fathers of this movement, and yet he says he believes that humans descended from other apes, from other animals, and some of them don't accept that. So some of them accept human evolution and some of them don't. So, you know, isn't there a consistency problem with what even the platform is trying to teach or proclaim?
Well, you know, I wouldn't disagree with what you're saying because, you know, one of the friendly criticisms that we've leveled against intelligent design are reasons to believe, and I would consider myself to be an ID person, but one of the criticisms we've leveled at it is that there's not a model that they have. So when you embrace intelligent design, kind of a, the Discovery Institute variety, are you embracing young earth creationism or old earth creationism? Are you embracing common descent or limited common descent or no common descent at all? You know, and so there's not really a clear model or even a clear collection of models that are being advanced. And so, you know, I think that criticism that you're leveling is about incoherence is a valid criticism.
So you make it sound, in your viewpoint, there's maybe different, do you guys have like a different form of intelligent design then? Because in my mind, I was just thinking intelligent design was just promoted by the Discovery Institute. Is there another proponent of it, or unofficial?
I would say that I'm an intelligent design proponent in the sense that I think there's evidence for design in the construct of the universe. I think biochemical systems are designed as well, you know, and even biological systems. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that we take this concept of intelligent design and we anchor it within a particular, you know, model that we would call old earth creationism, you know, and then within that we make some very specific, you know, statements as to how we think things transpired in the history of life on Earth.
Okay.
So we're trying, you know, in other words, a lot of what the Discovery Institute is focused on is really design detection, you know, versus, you know, and of course I think design detection is, you know, something that you would need to do to advance an intelligent design position. But just because you can detect design doesn't mean you've got any kind of model.
Okay.
So to me, it's unsatisfying for the reason that you're complaining about it being incoherent. because a model then would take that idea that you can detect design and then place it within a framework that attempts to have explanatory power about, mm-hmm. you know, the origin of life and the history of life, let's say.
Right, right. Yes. Yeah, they need to have some explanatory power, some predictions and all that. Okay, so the next question, got about a little over 7 minutes. You said, if the mind is the product of evolutionary processes, is it possible to know the truth? Do you want to explain that question?
Yeah, and this is, and I'm more curious as to how you would reply to this, because this is an argument that I've heard a number of Christian apologists make, mm-hmm. And I'm sympathetic to the argument, and that is, if the human mind is ultimately a product of evolutionary processes, the ultimate arbiter of what the mind looks like is survivability. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily ensuring that the mind is a system that's capable of truth detection.
Yeah, yeah. So basically evolution is all about filling ecological niches and surviving, and basically the argument is that we were not evolving to discern truth. That's not what evolution is about. It's not about discerning truth. It's about surviving, right?
Yes, exactly. And so, for example, you'd have people, and I hopefully I'm not misrepresenting his position, but you have people like Michael Shermer, for example, who would say human beings are pattern-seeking, pattern-recognizing creatures, and sometimes the patterns that we recognize are false patterns or false positives. But yet, because we more often than not identify patterns that actually are valid, that ensured our survivability being pattern-seeking, but kind of the spandrel or the byproduct of that is sometimes we actually see things mm-hmm. that are there that are not genuine patterns. And so he would argue that this explains essentially the origin of religion or the origin of the idea that there is a supernatural realm where we see agency when there in fact is none.
Right, right. Yeah, let me give my answer. I would have a different answer. My answer is that evolution is all about the fight for survival and the struggle for survival. And if you look at even the things that humans have done in our fight for survival, we weaponize all new discoveries. And for example, the GPS was created by the military. Nuclear technology, we created a nuclear bomb and that led to nuclear technology. And even when we make advanced computer chips, they have to limit the sales to so-called hostile countries like China and Russia, for example. They can't buy our latest, greatest chips or supercomputers or whatever because we got to keep back that technology. So because of the fight for survival, it is critical that we have a grasp on the truth. And in fact, animals actually even use deception. So if you can fool another animal, then you could have the upper hand and kill it for food or take over or whatever, dominate the space. So when you know the truth, you could also deceive other people. And if you don't know the truth, you can be deceived yourself. So for me, there is the obvious link of evolution and truth seeking. We need to be in the truth in order to survive because it's a struggle for survival. To me, I see that as kind of obvious. So I know Alvin Plantinga brings us up this argument, you know, like, well, naturalism is self-defeating because according to evolution, there's no reason to believe that we should know truth. And I'm thinking, if you know about evolution, I don't know how you could even say that.
Then how would you explain something like the origin of religion from an evolutionary perspective? Because again, and it's not just Shermer, but I've heard
but
other.
But that's a different question
atheists.
Now, too. But now you're going into a different question, right?
Well, but again, they would argue that the reason why religious systems emerge is because we're incapable of discerning the truth.
Right. I mean, it's like you see something move, and maybe there was something over there. We know things move. Things and if I can't see it, maybe there's something over there invisible that moved it, and maybe there's something in the dark. It could be a lion. Well, if there's nothing there, maybe there's a ghost. It's kind of funny. When I was a Christian, I used to actually be afraid of the dark. I used to have a little nightlight on or something, and when I became an atheist, it's like, okay, I don't think God exists. That means the devil doesn't exist. And so, you know, I got to practice with no light, nightlight. It's kind of funny. So, you know, because I don't have to worry about boogeymen and ghosts anymore, you know. So it's kind of like I'm tempting the devil. Come on, okay, ghost. You know, it's like I don't need any lights anymore, you know.
Yeah, interesting. So, yeah, okay, well, yeah, I mean, I've heard, just was really curious, again, how you would reply to that particular argument, because as you've mentioned, you know, Alvin Plantick advances that idea and other people do, and I actually find it compelling to some degree, you know, the goal is ultimately survivability, and if you can believe something that is false and it ensures survivability, then you can never be guaranteed that ultimately the mind is capable of discovering truth.
And, you know, I mean, just think about the most awesome technology and science there is. I mean, like right now, the most mind-blowing thing is quantum mechanics, you know, quantum computing and all this. And you know, the first thing that they're going to do is try to weaponize this. You know, the military, DARPA, you know, is investing heavily in all this stuff. It's just kind of obvious. Whenever there's some kind of new science or technology, it's weaponized, number one, right off the bat. And we want to get that technology before our enemies do. It's so ingrained in the fight for survival. You know, you can see the same thing with Neanderthals or whatever. If somebody's learning how to throw a stick or learning how to, you know, then they learn how to throw stones and then they develop steel. And it's like, we can throw this steel and okay, now we can shoot it. Now we got these big cannonballs. Let's make them smaller. We got bullets. And science gets applied to all these to make them more efficient killing machines, unfortunately. So we have like 40 seconds left. How would you like to summarize the program today?
Well, you know, I just appreciated the chance to be on the program and have the conversation with you. And, you know, I think to me at the end of the day, a lot of times people can look at the same data and draw very different conclusions. And in a sense, both conclusions can be rational and can be reasonable conclusions.
Yeah, yeah, and I appreciate our discussion too, and I always enjoy talking to you because you're one of the really smart Christians, and I find it interesting. I mean, it's more interesting than talking to a young earth creationist who thinks there's T-Rex on the ark eating hay, you know, for example, or a vegetarian, so. Okay, well, thanks for calling in. Really appreciate it.
Well, thanks for having me. Anytime, I'm happy to do it.
Okay. So one thing I wanted to talk to you about, I did a previous show with Kent Hovind. I'm sure you know who he is. He goes by the name Dr. Dino. And we had a section on morality, and I basically challenged him because he claims to have four PhDs. He says three of them are earned, one of them is an honorary degree, and he actually, even though he claims to have these four doctorate degrees, he will not name the other schools, but he does name one of them, Pacific University, which I think is strange to claim that you have doctorate degrees, but then I really pushed him, and he would not give the name of the school. I thought that was interesting. But, you know, you've got a real PhD, and so I think there's a real honesty issue here. In fact, I think maybe first he got one and then he just got used to it and got another one because people didn't challenge him on or whatever. But here's some points I want to bring up about it. Okay, so like I said, he claims three doctorates and one honorary, but he doesn't publicly name what the schools are except for Pacific or the Patriot University. And then when you question him about it, he goes, well, it's not important to him that they're not accredited schools, but actually Patriot University is accredited, and it's a known fraudulent accrediting agency called ACI. There's actually a story on the internet about how they got busted for being a sham accredited agency. It's kind of a humorous story. And then he also says that Patriot University is not accredited, because of course it's not accredited. They don't believe evolution. You know, you got to believe all this stuff in order to be accredited. But, you know, I'd point out that Baylor University, for example, is a Christian university. They're accredited. I got a seminary degree from Luther Rice Seminary in Georgia. It's a conservative Baptist. They don't believe in evolution, and they have accreditation. It's not first-tier accreditation from my school, but at least it's accredited by a decent accrediting agency. His school also has zero teaching faculty, zero. And, you know, basically it's like just a manufactured home. You could actually look at it on Google Maps. It's just a manufactured home. It's just, that's all it is, and it's a so-called university. To get the Doctor of Ministry on the website there, it says you take 12 courses, which are 36 credits plus a dissertation, 9 credits. It's 45 credits total. I think I saw somewhere else online, because I was interested in getting a PhD. I looked around. I think it was like 120 credits. And then they cost $2,189, basically $2,200 for a PhD there. And like I said, I looked into getting a PhD. They normally cost about 50 or... If I wanted to get a PhD in education, it would cost about $50,000. And I noticed there's actually one where I can get a PhD in something else for about $15,000 that was accredited. So, I mean, his is only $2,000 barely. So what is your take on this? I mean, do you think this is kind of a sinful thing to do, or a dishonest thing to do?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm deeply troubled when Christians, you know, misportray themselves as being experts when in fact they're not. And I mean, to be clear, there are many Christian scholars who have worked very hard to earn their degrees. You know, there are many people with, you know, PhDs and THDs and DMens, you know, that degrees that have worked very hard, as you mentioned, through schools that have been accredited, where these are rigorous degrees, and there are, you know, real, expertise that they're expected to develop. There's a lot of Christians in science who do have bona fide degrees, you know, and so, you know, to me, it's an insult to men and women who have really run the gauntlet and earned those degrees to portray yourself as something that you're not. And so, yeah, I'm deeply troubled by people that portray themselves in that way. I don't understand, you know, why they would do that, or, you know, how they could justify doing something like that.
Well, now, but if you're in a debate with him, Would you not bring this up, like it's a below the belt kind of hitting or something like that?
Yeah, that's a good question. If I would bring it up or not, and the reason I would say that is not because, again,
I mean especially if you phrase it like, hey, okay, you know, Fuzz, you got a PhD in microbiology, I got a PhD in Christian education, and let me tell you, blah blah blah, you know.
I might bring it up at that point. But, you know, to me, I think that, I mean, and this is just my style and my approach, is I would prefer to try to do the best job I could to make a case for my position, where I would, you know, bring out evidence. And I would not expect you to accept my position based on just simply the authority that undergirded by my degree, but rather I would expect you to accept my position because I've presented evidence and have made an argument that, you know, hopefully is a sound argument that's compelling. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm okay also too with critiquing another person's ideas and argument, you know, and try to point out places where I see problems. But, I don't know that I would go after a person's qualifications, because, you know, even though Ken Hovind, I think, has a, you know, frankly, a bogus degree, it doesn't mean that he can't make valid points or present valid arguments. And mm-hmm. So that's what I would choose to focus on.
What about the appearance of, like, he did a debate with Hugh Ross, and I don't know if he had his PhD back then, but I think it comes up sometimes. I think he might even just like name drop it down where they'll say, like, you know, maybe they'll put on subtitles like, you know, here's Hugh Ross, PhD, and then or Dr. Ross, and they might say, you know, and he might say, like, well, call me doctor too. I'm a doctor.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, again, you know, I find that to be problematic. And, you know, I think it's, you know, for somebody who is, you know, producing a television program, to not, it's one thing to have Kent Hovind on the program. He's a well-known public figure, you know, in this, you know, in young earth creationism. So I think it's legitimate to bring him onto a program because mm-hmm. of his prominence. But I think it's probably not the most responsible thing to actually communicate that he has a bona fide degree when in fact he doesn't.
You know, you said
subtitles or what have you.
And you said, well, you know, people with real PhDs, you know, they work really hard for those. And he says, hey, I worked hard for mine too. You know, my first book was my dissertation. But, you know, it's kind of a joke if you look online about his dissertation. Actually, I don't know. Like, for example, you wrote a dissertation for your PhD, right?
I sure did.
Now, is that publicly available that anybody can read it, or how does that work?
I mean, I don't know how easy it is to get a copy of somebody's PhD, but I think there is actually a service that archives all PhDs that, if you go through some kind of procedure, you can actually get the copy of the PhD.
Have you ever seen Kent Hovind's PhD by any chance?
No,
his,
I haven't.
His dissertation? I mean, if you ask him about it, he'll say, well, I don't know where it is. It got lost or something. But, you know, I think it was actually on WikiLeaks or something. They actually have it in, supposedly, you know, it's incomplete. And they'll say, well, he added to it later. And it's like, that's not, when you write a PhD dissertation, you don't add to it later. I mean, it's got to be complete, you know. And
yep.
And actually, when you read it, it's, you know, it's obviously not PhD level. It's like high school level, the way it's kind of written.
Yeah, well, you know, with my experience getting a PhD, it's only your dissertation is only partially meeting the requirements to earn the PhD. There's other things that you have to do as well that you have to accomplish, you know, to have the complete fulfillment of the requirements for the degree. So the dissertation is partial, but that a dissertation actually has to be evaluated by a committee of experts, and typically you bring in somebody at a university from another department to make sure that the department granting the degree is not doing something, you know, beneath the line.
Yeah.
And a lot of times people will bring in individuals who are experts outside of the university. Hmm. So I've sat on PhD committees where I was the outside person coming in. So my job was not only to evaluate the PhD, but in a sense to be a kind of a monitor to make sure that the university was actually going through a legitimate process to grant the degree. So there's actually a committee of people that vote to determine whether or not your dissertation fulfills requirements. And again, it's people that are experts in those areas, people that are part of that particular department, people outside that department, people outside that university. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you've completed a PhD, you really have run the gauntlet where you have people, going through the work with a fine-tooth comb, but then when it's done, it's done. Now, you could continue research in the area that you wrote your dissertation on. You know, but again, there's ways you communicate that research so that, again, people have confidence that the work that you're presenting has credibility. So that's why peer review is so important. I mean, even, you know, at Reasons to Believe, when we publish a book, we actually do our very best to have people review the manuscript would be friendly to our position, and also people that would be hostile to the position. So, for example, the update to Who Was Adam, we had two people from BioLogos review the manuscript, and they offered, you know, critical comments that we took seriously. You know, it doesn't mean that, you know, that the BioLogos people would agree with the contents of Who Was Adam.
Right.
But we did go out and solicit you know, their input and took it seriously as we shaped the manuscript.
And you said, so you basically said there'd be some outsiders coming in to look at it too, just to make sure that the department's on track at the university. Yes. But, you know, in this case, they have zero faculty also. So it's like, what does that say? I mean, they don't even have a department, it sounds like.
Yeah, well, I don't understand how you could grant somebody a Ph.D. without there being at least a faculty advisor. Because, again, the idea is you have a faculty advisor who has a degree and who has experience in that particular field, who is guiding your research and is, in effect, teaching you through a process of being an apprentice how to function as a scholar in that area. You know, and then, of course, when you're doing your defense, it's not only you that's on trial, but it's also your Ph.D. advisor.
What do you think about too? I mean, you said, there's a lot of hard work to get a Ph.D. And he says, well, I did work hard. I wrote, you know, my book reflects that. I worked hard for it. I just didn't pay money and got a degree. I worked hard. So, I mean, yeah, he did some work, but there's a huge difference between doing a lot of work and doing Ph.D. level work, right?
Right. Yeah. I mean, but it's, you're doing hard work to get a Ph.D. And again, he very well could have worked hard as well. But that hard work is also in the context of, again, where there's certain criteria that you have to achieve. So it's not just simply working hard, but it's working hard to make sure you're attaining a particular standard and maintaining, you know, the quality of your work at that standard or even higher than that standard.
Okay.
You know, and the only way you can do that is within a community of people who are scholars, you know, who are holding one another accountable as well.
Okay. Anything else you want to say about that before we move on to our next topic?
Nothing other than, it's something that I think deeply saddens me that, there are a handful of Christians that portray themselves as experts when in fact they're not.
Well, I did a little bit of look on the internet too, and it seems like there is a little bit of a faction. There are some like Christian, I think there's Christian celebrities on TV, some of the charismatic ones. They say, you know, like, I don't know if it's Dr. Price or not, but there's Dr. So-and-so, Dr. So-and-so. I mean, some of these charismatic leaders just get, they call themselves doctor, and they don't really have real doctor's degrees, but they just get into this, I don't know, some kind of groupthink where they can get away with that, I guess. Okay, so the next question I wanted to talk to you about was your curious place in origin debates. One way I see it is that there's basically, for Christians, there's three major groups. There's young earth creationists, and these people think the universe is really young, like 6,000 years old, and they don't accept evolution. Then there's old earth creationists, which you're in the camp where you accept all modern science as far as cosmology, but you disagree with what modern science would say about evolution as taught in the state universities. And then there's evolutionary creationists, which would say that they totally accept all modern science, all cosmology, all evolutionary science and everything. So you being in the middle, you can agree with the young earth creationists that evolution is not good science, but you disagree with them on the age of the earth. And on the other side, you can agree with the evolutionary creationists about the cosmos and the age of the universe, but disagree with them about evolution. So how's life in the middle there? What's that like for you?
Well, it's pretty lonely because nobody is happy with us, with our position. And, you know, what really motivates our view is essentially the idea that we take what science presents very seriously, and we take, Scripture very seriously, and we're looking at how can you come up with a model that would integrate both accounts, the biblical account and the scientific record, recognizing there may be places where there is tension, where there might be points where there is conflict or at least apparent conflict. And so in those places, you know, we might then challenge what might be a more commonplace or, you know, popular interpretation of Scripture, but we also might be willing to challenge certain scientific ideas. But the idea is that any challenge that we bring to a biblical interpretation or to a scientific idea has to be, you know, based on a rigorous critique that has hopefully legitimacy to it. And so, you know, that's essentially what we're trying to do, is really integrate a biblical account and a scientific account, trying to be true as we can to both enterprises, but yet also be willing to go against mainstream thinking in science or in certain areas of theology, if that need be.
Well, let me say something. Tell me if you agree with me or not. It seems to me, within Christianity, that the young Earth creationist viewpoint is a minority opinion, but in the public sphere, as far as what you hear, it sounds like it's a dominant position. As far as you know, the voices does that seem? What do you think about that?
I don't know that I would agree or disagree with that statement. I think, in my experience, at least among evangelicals, probably young Earth creationism is the dominant view. But a lot of times people hold to that view without ever having thought through the issue. So they kind of hold that view from a default perspective. But an increasing number of evangelicals actually are moving towards at least either embracing or at least acknowledging the legitimacy of an old Earth perspective. I think I actually saw recently some survey data done by Lifeway Research where they said roughly 50% of evangelical pastors are comfortable with an old Earth position, but only about 25% would be comfortable with evolutionary creationism. So you have a preponderance of evangelicals being anti-evolutionists, for lack of a better term, but about 50% being young Earth creationists. But then if you broaden it to include not just evangelicals, but mainline Protestants or even Catholics, then I would actually think old Earth creationism is probably, or at least an old Earth perspective, is probably extremely widespread. And when you include mainline Protestants and then, you know, Catholics, you probably are looking at a very high level of evolutionary creationism.
So, I mean, the Catholics, I would like to talk to a priest sometime, but it's kind of impossible to find somebody that would talk, I think, so far. Let me know if you ever know of a priest that would like to talk to me, but...
Sure.
would you say the priests are like the evolutionary creationists?
Yeah, I would say that.
Boy, yeah. I don't know. I'm really perplexed about that. I grew up as a Catholic, and then I became a born again evangelical Christian. Catholicism is really strange. I met a priest. We were talking about the soul, and he was talking about how the soul emerged and everything. And I was saying, you know, that makes sense, but that seems like it's against the Catholic faith. And he goes, well, you know, I don't know. You don't really have to believe everything, I guess, or don't tell anybody or something. I don't know, you know, something along those lines or whatever. The Catholics are used to believing whatever they want to believe, I think. It's kind of strange.
Yeah.
I mean, they're still trying to work in Adam and Eve and with evolution. I don't know. I think that's a breaking point myself. So I would love to challenge. I want to get some of these BioLogos people, I guess. I talked to them about that, too.
Well, you know, I mean, in a sense, that's why, in large measure, I hold the position that I hold, is I don't fundamentally have a problem with the idea that God could use evolution as a way to create. But then when I look at the biblical account of human origins, I just don't know how to square that with the idea of human evolution. And so in a sense, that kind of forces me into a position where I have to be skeptical to some degree about facets of the evolutionary paradigm. However, you know, when I was an agnostic in graduate school, it was really the inability to account for the the origin of life that convinced me there had to be a creator. And so I, since my first year of graduate school, I've been a skeptic of the evolutionary paradigm when it comes to the origin of life. So, you know, I've never held to the idea of chemical evolution. So, I mean, there are things I think that the evolutionary framework cannot account for, at least as things currently stand. And so that also, I think, in part fuels my position as well, as I do see places where I see the evolutionary paradigm is insufficient. That's partly, again, why I hold the position that I hold. You know, I think that the age of the Earth is extremely well established from science, but I think it's very easy to square that idea with a reading of Scripture that I think upholds the integrity of Scripture. But
Who do you feel closer to, the young Earth creationists or the evolutionary creationists, do you think? Do you kind of tilt one way?
I probably feel closer to the evolutionary creationists in the sense that I think evolutionary creationists are much more actively involved in a truth-seeking enterprise, because, you know, with people from Biologos, I think they acknowledge kind of the biblical and theological issues that are associated with their position, and they're wrestling through those issues. I would like to think that our work at Reasons to Believe is more characterized by that, where we're not necessarily dogmatic on a lot of our positions, though we hold to them firmly. Mm-hmm. We're still wrestling through and modifying and refining things, whereas I don't see that characterizing young Earth creationism.
Hey, let me ask you a question. Do you think that, this might be a funny way to phrase it, do you think the young Earth creationists are, if they see a science-religion conflict, they are bending towards the religion or tending towards believing the Bible literally if there's a conflict? They want to go to the Bible over science, and that the evolutionary creationists are the opposite way, where they're going to science more than the Bible if there's a conflict? Do you see that kind of bend?
I would agree with that characterization. Yeah, I would agree with that characterization. And, you know...
And then you'd probably say that you're a middle ground. You're doing it just right.
Well, I mean, everybody, of course, you know, holds their position for, you know, for reasons, you know... that they think are sound reasons. But, you know, in a sense, you know, our perspective is, if you see conflict between, let's say, what you think Scripture is saying and what science is saying, our approach is essentially to reevaluate our interpretations and to ask the question, do we have our interpretations correct, not only of Scripture, but of science? And so, you know, at Reasons to Believe, we have gone through, you know, closed-door exercises where we've asked the question, you know, do we have to embrace a historical Adam and Eve? And, you know, we always come out of those deliberations saying we just don't see any way around it. But we have gone back and evaluated, you know, kind of a traditional understanding of human origins and, you know, again, through that exercise come out saying, no, I think this is really the way to understand Scripture. And okay. Likewise, you know, we evaluate scientific ideas in that same way, you know, but I guess my sense would be if I reached a point where I thought that this is what Scripture says and it is in conflict with science, I probably would give deference to Scripture at the end of the day, because I've also seen situations
where the science changes, or
where over time science has changed and, okay. You know, and where what something that looked like to be a serious challenge turned out over time to actually, you know, provide support, you know, for the Christian faith. So
okay. Can we go on to another topic?
Sure.
Do you? I know you do a lot of research on upcoming or the latest news and stuff. Do you follow global warming very much, that debate?
I follow it only. You know, only marginally. I'm you know, just not I'm not trained in paleoclimatology, and so I'm very much a layperson, you know, in that arena. I mean, my approach is not to be there's a number of people that are global warming skeptics that have an inherent distrust of the scientific enterprise. And I wouldn't, you know, characterize myself in that way. So I'm not, you know, if a bulk of the scientific community says there's climate change that's happening and we've got data supporting that, I'm inclined to accept that even without necessarily evaluating things for myself.
The only reason why I was asking you is because I saw a recent news article, and I'm also like yourself. I don't really follow it, the debates and things, so I'm not really all that educated about it. But one thing interesting I saw recently in the news, and that's why I wanted to see if you had a take on it, was they're saying because of global warming, it actually threw the Earth cycles off kilter. And so there was supposed to be a coming ice age, and because of the global warming, we're going to miss that ice age. So it's like, oh, does that mean global warming actually was good if we're going to avoid an ice age? I mean, ice age, that's going to be a huge, you know, that's opposite of global warming, and that's going to destroy a lot of things.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't want to go through an ice age. I know that much. Yeah, you know, somebody who I really respect, who you might actually find interesting, maybe even as a guest on your program, is a guy by the name of Kevin Birdwell. He's a Ph.D. in paleoclimatology. He works at Oak Ridge National Labs, and he is an evangelical Christian and has an association with Reasons to Believe kind of on a volunteer basis. And he has one of the most balanced approaches to the question of global warming that I've seen. And kind of his bottom line is there really is climate change that's happening. Human beings probably have precipitated that climate change to some degree, but it's not really clear, you know, how much human activity is actually causing this and how much would have just happened anyway as a result of different, you know, cycles that are in operation in nature. And, you know, his perspective is he's not convinced that some of the attempts that we're taking to remediate global warming are going to be effective. And he argues that we're better off investing in technologies and in you know, activities that would help us to adapt to the changing climate as opposed to trying to stop it from changing. But, you know, you might be interested in maybe at some point having him on the program just to have kind of a somebody who actually has studied this quite extensively. That's where his expertise is. And, you know, he does come at it from the perspective of an evangelical, but he seems to me to be very fair-minded and very balanced and thoughtful.
Okay, well, I guess we'll have to end the show on that note. Appreciate you calling in, Fuzz. Really appreciate the conversation. Enjoyed it.
Yes, I enjoyed it too, Bernie. Thanks for having me.
Okay, take care.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye.